Good morning. Let's hear it again. Good morning. Yay. All right. We're awake and we are glad to be in the house of the Lord today. I am Pastor Diane, and on behalf of Pastor Will, Pastor Elizabeth, and the mighty, mighty CrossRoads Worship team, welcome to the service of worship at First Presbyterian Church, Hilton Head Island. We are so glad the Spirit has brought you here today, whether you are a first-time visitor, a long-time member, whether you are joining us in this space or online. And we're so glad to have our online worshipers with us. Today is another wonderful day to be in worship. Pastor Will is going to continue our sermon on the hard sayings of Jesus, talking about God's grace. So amazing, so undeserved. But sometimes we wonder, is it fair? So he's going to help us process all that and look at what Jesus tells us. Now, here at First Presbyterian Church, we value connecting with God and with one another. So let me invite you to take those red friendship registers at the beginning of your pew rows and ask you to put your name and other information on them. Then go ahead and just pass them along the row. When they get to the end, send them on back. And don't be shy to look at the names of the folks seated around you. In just a few minutes, we'll have a chance to greet one another. And it would be wonderful if we could call each other by name. While you're doing that, you'll notice, too, that there are prayer cards in those friendship pads. If you have a prayer concern, please fill that out, give it to an usher, or put it in the basket in the back. There are also more prayer cards in the back. Don't worry, just get up whenever the Spirit moves and go fill one out. And likewise, for our folks online, we'd love to have you let us know that you are worshiping with us today. We really do see all the names that come through each week, and we celebrate. You can use that QR code, just put your device near the screen, or you can go to our homepage, fpchhi.org, and about halfway down, there's a connect button. Just press that and you can let us know that you're here. And likewise, if you have a prayer concern, you can always email Pastor Will, Pastor Elizabeth, or me, or you can use one of the snazzy QR codes that are on our connection cards. And there's also some of those cards in the back for the folks that are here. You can not only let us know about a prayer concern, you can learn how to better connect, you can give, and you can learn about ways to serve. So we hope that you will take advantage of that opportunity. Now, as we talk about connecting, we have been scattered far and wide during the summer, but now that things are sort of getting back into the rhythm as we look toward fall, we are going to be gathering for a wonderful dinner and a game night. Celebrity chef Charles Sampson, who just happens to be a member of our church, will be cooking Boston butts. And I had to look up what that was, but it is the best part of the pig. And so they're smoked, they're grilled, they're cut up, and barbecue and all the fixings will be yours if you simply sign up. It's $12. Kids eat under 12 eat free. You can go to our website. There are details in our bulletin announcements, which you probably received, or on our website. So we hope to see you there. Also, just want to invite, if you are, again, have been visiting with us, even for years, you are involved maybe in the life of the church, but you've not yet made it official. We today are having our monthly membership class. Come to join us, 11:45 in our library, which is just down the hall that way. No pressure to join, but it is a time to understand better what it means to be a disciple at this locale of the body of Christ, what our ministries and missions are about, and to get to know one another and get to know the pastors and the elders who are attending the class. So we hope that you will consider coming if you are so moved by the Spirit. Well, with those things being said, again, in the great joy that comes as we gather in the presence of the Lord, let's stand as we are able, greet one another, fist bump, wave, a bow, but let's make sure we start by saying hello to everybody online, giving them a big wave. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Truly good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. To God be the glory. It's not about us, it's about Him. And we, as always, we encourage you to participate in the praise and in the worship. Please join us in the song, Not to Us. Join me in a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this opportunity to be together one more time in your presence. We know that you are already here, so put us on one accord that all we say and do might glorify you. We thank you for your mercy and for your grace, and we just simply thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen.
All my days I've been held.
You have led me through the fire.
In darkest night,
you are close like no other.
I know you as a father. I know you as a friend.
Amen. Thanks be to God. And good morning. For those of you who may have forgotten who I am Reverend Will Robinson, as Pastor Diane said, one of the pastors here at First Presbyterian Church. And if you're questioning why I'm saying that, it's because I have not been here for a number of Sundays. That is mostly because I was with a group from our church, some of whom are here today, on a mission trip to Kenya for our Bahati Scholarship Program. Thanks be to God for that mission. Some of you have asked about our mission trip, and in a word, it was transformative. Transformative especially and mostly because of how God blessed us in the relationships with the students that we are sponsoring, with the members of the presbytery, the local governing body of Presbyterian churches there, just like it is here, and those relationships we have. And with Susan Nagari, who is our social worker, we pay for her to run the program there. And then, of course, the students themselves, 75 students that this congregation provides an education to, high school and college, because in Kenya, a public education is only to grade 8. So for them to have prospects, to be able to have more opportunity, especially in a nation with such a high rate of unemployment, we are giving them hope, and we are giving them a future they may not have otherwise. Amen. Thanks be to God. As an example of the relationships we developed there, I'm wearing this cross. It's a Maasai cross, and it was crafted by a member of the Maasai tribe or community in Kenya, one of 42 communities in that nation. And it was given to me by Reverend Peter. You'll see a picture of Reverend Peter and me here on the screen. He's holding his cross, and now I am holding my cross that he gave to me as a gift. He's a pastor at the Eastleigh Presbyterian Church in Nairobi, a member of the presbytery there. There's a school that his church has, and some of the students at that school are students that we sponsor. Again, we provide an education for them they would not have access to otherwise, high school, and some of them college. So we were able to meet those students in person. What a joy that was. And then in the next picture, you'll see me and Grace. Grace Wamuyu, she is the student that my family has sponsored the past 4 years. So she began as a freshman in high school, and she is now a senior. She's would like to attend college and study engineering. What a joy it was to be able to give her a big hug, to spend some time with her, and to get to know her better personally, and allow her to get to know me a little better personally as well. Thank you. Grace, her name itself is the segue then to the word of the Lord today, because as you heard Pastor Diane say, we're going to hear more about God's radical, truly amazing grace. Before I say more about that, just remember that if you, like me, have missed some Sundays, this Hard Sayings of Jesus series is on our YouTube channel. So you can head back and watch or hear the good news preached in this series anytime you would like. Today's Hard Saying of Jesus is based on a parable of our Lord, a parable in Matthew's Gospel, Matthew 20. Our Lord tells this parable to his disciples then, and he tells it to us, his disciples, here this day. Listen to the word of the Lord. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received a denarius. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And when they had received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to those who only worked 1 hour the same that I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you resentful because I am generous?" Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join me in prayer. Lord, the scripture we just heard and the message we are about to hear are just words, unless we hear them as your word to us. So, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, may they be your word to us this day and always. Amen. Life's not fair. I experienced that on our mission trip to Kenya. After a good but tiring Sunday morning, we were still a little jet-lagged at that point, we spent most of Sunday afternoon at a museum of Kenyan history and culture, where baboons and warthogs roam the grounds freely. So you'll see a picture here of a couple of baboons and a couple of warthogs roaming the grounds of this Museum of Kenyan History and Culture. Thank you. As we stood in the parking lot of that museum, preparing to leave, I was thirsty. And our hosts, as they would the entire trip, provided us with something to eat and drink. I chose passion fruit flavored Fanta. Not available here in the United States. I opened it and I enjoyed a refreshing swig of my new favorite drink. It's like the old Coca-Cola commercials. Have a Coke and a smile. But then, like a flash of lightning, this happened. This baboon stole my still mostly full passion fruit flavored Fanta drink, the only one available to us at that time. Look at his face. No remorse, no guilt. Life is just not fair. Thank you. That, of course, is a very lighthearted example of the truth that life sometimes isn't fair. Of course, there are better examples. The person who dies of lung cancer, even though she never smoked. Or the loved one who is killed by a drunk driver. Or innocent children who die in a senseless act of violence at their school. The book of Job explores this truth, especially the truth of unjust suffering that we experience in our lives. And Archibald MacLeish's 1950s play, J.B., is a modern retelling of Job's story. It won a Pulitzer Prize. And he retold that story of Job in that play because he wanted to say that we as human beings have the ability to cope even with the unjust suffering that we experience in our lives. So yes, we know that life sometimes is unfair because we have experienced it ourselves. Amen? This is especially true when we think about what we deserve or what we think we deserve based on our hard work or our education and training or our talents and abilities. We might say something like, or hear someone say something like, "It's not fair. I worked so much harder than he did, but he was the one who was promoted." So we can relate to the workers in today's story who grumble against that landowner. Can't you see them standing in that line of workers? They are hot and sweaty at the end of a full day's work. And they see the manager give the 5 o'clock workers, those last workers, a denarius, the daily wage for labor in Jesus' day. Their eyes open wider and smiles line their faces as they think to themselves, if they were paid a denarius, I can't wait to see how much I will be paid. But when the manager gets to them, he gives each of them a denarius too. What? That's not fair. they grumble against that landowner. These last worked only 1 hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of this day and the scorching heat. We can relate. Amen. But this isn't just a story about how life isn't fair. It's a parable about life in God's kingdom. Right before Jesus tells this parable, his disciples had asked Jesus what they were going to get for following him, how much they would get paid by Jesus. And Jesus answers them, promising them a glorious reward at the end of time and supremely the gift of eternal life. But Jesus has more to say to them about rewards, about the pay scale in God's kingdom. And he expresses that right here in this parable. 1500s Protestant reformer Martin Luther says it very well, what Jesus is saying here, when he writes, God doesn't deal with us according to what we do, according to what we deserve, but according to grace. God doesn't deal with us according to our work, what we do, according to what we deserve or think we deserve. He deals with us according to grace. One of the lyrics of a beloved song, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Yes, this is not a story about unfair life, but about unfair grace. So I want to place that phrase here on the screen because I would like to say a little more about unfair grace, and I want you to have that in your minds as we do so. Unfair life and unfair grace are not the same. Thanks be to God and amen. Amen. Unfair life. Jesus needs, he wants and needs his disciples to open their eyes to see that in God's kingdom, there would be long-time disciples and last-minute believers, upstanding Jews like Paul and despised Jews like the Good Samaritan, the good son and the prodigal son, the faithful Marys and the salacious prostitutes, the well-to-do and the dirt poor, insiders and outcasts, the Jews and the Gentiles. And Jesus wants, needs us, his disciples here this day, to open our eyes to the unfair grace of God's kingdom. I think, for example, of how we often see others as not worthy of that grace, not deserving, we don't think. Have they truly done enough to be in God's good graces? Like Jesus' disciples then, Martin Luther in the 1500s, and Christians at all times and places, we too sometimes question where others are on God's pay scale, or if they are even on God's pay scale. And Christians are guilty of thinking this about other Christians, not even just non-Christians. There was a time, for example, when many Catholics didn't believe Protestants could be saved. And some evangelical Christians, even today, would question whether we at FPC will be saved. That sad truth is illustrated well and humorously in this clip from the 80s and early 90s hit sitcom Cheers. Let's take a look.
Hi, guys.
What are you doing back here?
How come you're not on your honeymoon?
Honeymoon? Is that what you call it when two people lock themselves in a room and refuse to speak or even look at each other?
No, well, that's marriage.
Hey, what happened?
Well, Kelly and I found out we're from different religions.
I thought you and Kelly were both Lutheran.
Oh, well, that's what I thought. Turns out she's Lutheran Church of America. I'm Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. But if we had children, we'd have half-breeds.
Perhaps Lilith and I could provide some help.
Oh, that's nice, Dr. Parent. I'll ask Kelly. She's not too busy begging at airports or whatever those people do.
Hi, everyone.
Kelly, I admire you for coming.
Well, I believe a marriage is worth saving.
Well, that's not all she believes. Ask her why she believes the Book of Concord and the scriptures are on the same level. Go ahead, ask her.
Because they're not.
That's why the sacraments are considered vehicles of grace. Go ahead, I dare you.
They're symbolic memorials.
Heretics!
The good news of Jesus' parable is that God's grace is unfair. So that Lutheran Church of America Christians and Lutheran Church Missouri Synod Christians, Republicans and Democrats, the well-to-do and the dirt poor, insiders and outcasts, longtime disciples and last-minute believers, those you think who would be shoe-ins to God's kingdom, and those you think would never stand a chance. Flannery O'Connor, the Christian and accomplished short story writer, expresses this unfair grace very well in her short story, Revelation. In that short story, Ruby Turpin is a smug, self-righteous Southern woman who experiences unfair grace herself, but who is not very willing to support unfair grace when it's expressed to others. Near the end of the story, though, Ruby has this vision. We read, "She saw a vast swinging bridge extending upward from the earth through a field of living fire. Upon the bridge, a vast horde of souls were rumbling toward heaven. There were whole companies of white trash clean for the first time in their lives, and battalions of freaks and lunatics shouting and clapping and leaping like frogs. And bringing up the end of the procession was a tribe of people whom Ruby recognized at once as those who, like herself, had always had a little of everything and the God-given wit to use it right. But even they were marching behind the others with great dignity, and yet she could see in their shocked and altered faces that even their virtues were being burned away." That is one side of the unfair grace coin. On the other side of that same coin is this: it is never too late. It is never too late to labor in God's vineyard. It is never too late to add you and your God-given gifts and abilities to the work of God's kingdom. Remember our Lord's parable before this one. The harvest is plentiful, and the laborers are few. It's never too late to know, love, and serve the very God who created you and loves you more than words are able to express. Notice, for example, that the landowner, i.e., God, goes out again and again and again. And whenever there are workers there willing to work, what does he do? He puts them to work. As one commentator on today's passage observes, Jesus may have had in mind here tax collectors, sinners, and other ne'er-do-wells. Jesus needed his disciples to know that God's unfair grace accepted them too, even if they were Johnny-come-latelys to God's kingdom, or if his own disciples didn't think that they deserved it. In the lyrics of a beloved hymn, God opened the life gate that all may go in, whenever that is. In fact, some ancient commentators on this passage, like St. Augustine or Augustine, interpreted the different times of day, 9 o'clock, noon, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock. Some of those ancient commentators interpreted those different times of day as different ages or stages of life. childhood, youth, middle age, older adults. So, in interpreting this passage, they saw the Lord putting to work the vital youth, no matter how young you are, as well as the elderly, no matter how old you are. And he pays them the same. God is generous to whomever, whenever they join the work of God's kingdom. Yes, it is never too late to work in God's kingdom. Thanks be to God for his unfair grace that flows to those who do not deserve it, including you and me. Amen.
Amen and amen. And thank goodness God's grace isn't fair. Thank goodness. Through your generosity, First Presbyterian Church is changing lives and creating disciples. Through our missionary, Stephanie Black, who is a seminary professor that teaches Christian leaders in Africa and Asia. She is based in Nairobi, Kenya, where she teaches and supervises graduate students. This is a busy lady. She also serves as the Associate Director for Theologians Without Borders, an initiative that fosters fair trade partnerships in global theological education, and is also a part-time Associate Professor of New Testament at Fuller Theological Seminary, teaching students online. Our global outreach ministry sends supports Stephanie with $8,000 a year for her to work and train the next generation to serve as pastors. So thank you for your generosity. Will the ushers please come forward to gather in God's tithes and our offerings?
Where would I be? You only know. I'm glad you see through eyes of love. A hopeless cave, an empty place, if not for grace. Where would I be? Oh, you only know. I'm glad you see through eyes of love. A hopeless cave, an empty place. A shelter in the storms of life, a shield surrounding me, and I thank you for the mercy you provide. Oh, but I know you could have walked away, but you stayed a thousand times. Hopeless cave, an empty place. days. Well, you only know. I'm glad you see through eyes of love a hopeless case, an empty place. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. I once was lost, but thank God I found a hopeless case, an empty place.
Will you pray with me? Holy One, we have come for a glimpse of your kingdom of kindness, a world where love rules over all, a world where enemies embrace, a world where the distinction between friend and foe evaporate in the light of your love. Knowing you have the power to transform us, help us give our lives over to you, body, soul, mind, and spirit. For your love is never exhausted, and your mercy flows unending through our lives. By your grace, you touch our fears with the fire of your compassion. You touch our brokenness with the fire of your forgiveness. You touch our hearts with the fire of your love. We are thankful. By your grace, you step into our lives and an unpredictable journey begins. You challenge us to new ways of thinking and deep ways of loving those you put in our path. You confront our doubts and cast out our fears, giving us instead your spirit of forgiveness, acceptance, and inclusion. Continue to gently nudge us that we may open ourselves to your ways and can show your grace to others. By your grace, you give us eyes to see the emptiness in our world, that we might companion those who are grieving or living with illness, and those who are battling addiction, depression, or anger. Give us ears to hear the cries of those in need of clean water, medical help, living wages, food, and shelter. Give us words to bring hope to all people, offering them encouragement and grace, that they may know they are loved by you and by us. God, this day, hear our prayers for those in our hearts that we now speak aloud to you. God, this day we pray for Alex, who was injured at work. We pray for all those that are suffering for those recovering from surgery, for those on their way to see a parent who has broken a leg. God, by your grace, we are who we are, your children, your people, and your church. Buoy us in the sustainable wonder of your dreams for us. Guide our steps in the days ahead that we might have your wise discernment and your ways of grace. We pray this in all things in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please stand and join us as we close out? I'm so grateful for the word of God and the message today, and I'm reminded of so many things. And I think about earlier in the year, you remember your star words. Mine was mercy, but grace is certainly one of those words I know. And we think about why some people have more than others or why some people suffer more than others. So I thank God for Pastor Will and the word that he brings to us. Go forward today on your Sunday and just realizing that God's grace is sufficient. Your grace is enough. Your love and justice.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. Thanks be to God. We love this Crossroads Worship and Music team. Amen. And thanks be to God for God's unfair grace that flows to those who don't deserve it, including you and me. And may we extend that grace then to those who we don't think deserve it, and extend it to those who may join us in the work of God's kingdom whenever they do, however old or young they are. And all of God's grace-saved people said, Amen.
Your love and justice, God of Jacob.
You use the weak,
you use the weak to lead us on.
And you lead us in the song of
you.
Remember?